immigration really changed into a national security type of thing, right? And so under DHS, we have USCIS, which is the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services. And basically, that agency really takes care of a lot of the paperwork. And so, like DACA, renewal applications get sent to USCIS. If you want to come here on a permit, on a work visa, then you go to USCIS to get some of that information. And so they do a lot of, they mostly do information sharing and paperwork. CBP, which is the Custom and Border Control, and those folks, you primarily see them like at the, whenever you go through customs at the airport, you'll see custom agents there, and Border Patrol are the folks along the borders on land. And then the other one is ICE, which is the Immigration and Customs Enforcer, which is kind of the law enforcement of the Department of Homeland Security. And so those are the three agencies that you'll definitely hear a lot about. And it's important to know what each of those agencies do, just to, you know, kind of learn more about the immigration system. And then the other two are the Justice Department, which handles the immigration courts. And then the other one is the State Department, which handles a lot of visas, but also the diplomacy of how we get along with other countries, right? So all of this you'll definitely learn in these three guides. This one is a one sheet. Also knowing that the immigration system is not just about undocumented folks, you know, it's visas, it's refugees, asylum, all of these types of statuses that folks are able to apply for are also part of the immigration system, right? So definitely encourage you all to learn about that. The next thing is to learn about the undocumented population. I mean, one of the ways that we definitely get informed is through the news, and oftentimes some of the numbers or some of the representations of folks are really misguided. And so definitely learning a little bit about who undocumented folks are, what types of languages they speak, where they come from, where do they settle once they come into the U.S., the states that have the largest number of undocumented folks, it's really important to learn about them, right? So here I have four different resources for you all to look at. The U.S. Department of Homeland Security definitely keeps track of all of this information. And if you read this report, which is actually pretty comprehensive, it's only about 4 or 5 pages long, you'll be able to see the charts of where folks are estimated or, estimated to be living. The state of Washington also has a report that they release every year with population trends that is really important. It's not specific to undocumented folks, but some of that is definitely taken into account. The city of Seattle also puts out information. Again, this one's not directly to undocumented folks, but it's definitely important to kind of see the population of the city, right? So that's a little bit about that. And so the next thing is to learn about laws and policies at the federal and state level. And this one is really important because some things are very institutionalized, and even resources that we're unaware of that undocumented, specifically undocumented students are eligible for. And so these are three resources that you all can take a look at. And it's important to know that some federal programs for undocumented students specifically don't qualify for certain federal programs like federal money, like the FAFSA, food stamps, health insurance, those are just three things. And so if you look at this, if you look at this chart, it'll give you a very comprehensive view of what folks are eligible based on their immigration status. So US citizens, green card holders, visa holders, et cetera. Also, since we're here at a higher education institution, there's a federal law that definitely protects student privacy that I think everyone should know, both students, educators, staff, and it's called FERPA. And the Department of Education put out a Student Privacy 101 video. Definitely, if you watch the video, give it up to like minute 4, because it goes really fast, and then it says, you see, that was really fast, let's slow down a little. So definitely, because I was like, why is this video going so fast? I don't get it. But it's meant to kind of inform you that a lot of these legal things you know, are being told at us, and we're like, I don't even know what that means. So it's kind of a comprehensive video that I definitely encourage you all to learn about, and to watch to learn about. And so this is definitely another thing. And so this is at the federal level, right? And then the other thing is to really know that everyone has basic rights, which are your constitutional rights, no matter what your immigration status really is, right? The next one is Washington State. So this was at the federal level of some federal laws that apply to everyone. Here in the state of Washington, we have other resources, right? So folks are still able to apply for driver's licenses and IDs. So that's definitely something that that folks should know. For students specifically, even if DACA has been rescinded, students are able to still apply for in-state tuition if they meet residency requirements. And they're also able to apply for state financial aid if they meet residency requirements, right? So that's really important. They definitely have resources on these two things further on. But yeah, these are really important as well.
Is state financial aid WAFSA?
Yes.
Yes.
So WAFSA is the application. Just as like the FAFSA, you fill out the application. So what it is the state of Washington passed the Real Hope Act, which expanded the definition of residency for tuition purposes and to be eligible for the state aid grant, which is state financial aid. And then they made a whole application just for folks who would be eligible for in-state tuition, who are presumed undocumented. So that could also be students who are here on visas and are not U.S. citizens, for example.
Oh yeah, I just wanted to say that with listeners' permission, I can post the PowerPoint on the library's website. We have a specific guide where you can go and get the links for all of these resources so that you're not having to scribble them down frantically. That's all I have to say.
So there's definitely the WAFSA, it's the actual application, which stands for Washington Application for State Financial Aid, something like that. And so this is at the state level. And then also noting that King County and both the city of Seattle have some things that they've implemented as well. So King County has put together some information or an ordinance that they won't corroborate or limit their cooperation with ICE. And so that's really important to note as well, you know, whenever you interact with either law enforcement from the county or from the city. And the city of Seattle as well has put together an executive order reaffirming Seattle as a welcoming city. And the welcoming city thing is not just like a for show thing. It actually has some technical things that have gone into it. So for example, if you want to go to a community center and enroll for a class that's offered at a community center, city employees will not ask for citizenship status or proof of any of that. So that's just one example. So definitely looking at some of the things that have already been implemented at the federal, at the state, at the local level that are definitely useful to know about. The next slide is going to be really packed with information, but again, we will share it. Number four is to learn about ongoing community efforts. So a lot of organizations have been doing really great work already for a really long time here in the state of Washington, in the city of Seattle, and beyond. And so I just want to highlight four organizations. One, the Washington Immigrant Solidarity Network has a hotline to report immigration activity. We do have an immigration detention center here in the state of Washington, and it's in Tacoma. And so definitely noting that, but there has been, you know, some immigration agent-related activity here in the state of Washington. The Northwest Immigrant Rights Project, they're a legal counsel organization, and they do a lot of work at the detention center, but also in advocating immigrant rights, informing folks about different things that are going on, and so they're really great as well. The ACLU has great information about Know Your Rights in various languages, and I actually brought some of the pocket cards that I got from them. So they're at the table over there. So you all can take one as you head out, and they're in multiple languages. I only have about 4 different languages with me today. But these are useful to carry with you. And this goes back to what I said earlier about that everyone has kind of basic rights, right? And so this is part of them, informing ourselves about what our rights are and actually using them whenever it comes up, right? And then the last one is the Educators for Fair Consideration, which has various fact sheets. And I actually use them so much because all of the information that's on their website is really, really comprehensive, and it's really useful. And some of this guide is kind of really influenced and informed by some of the work that they've already done. And they're based out of California. So definitely important on both efforts. And so now we're going to get into the action-oriented stuff, right? So now that you've learned all of these things and you're experts in immigration, the immigration system, and about what's happening, about different laws at multiple levels, now you can do stuff, right? And so number 5 is to really engage with an open mind. And so these are just kind of 4 things that I would advise everyone to do, is to always be in learning mode. That although you've learned all of these things already, you can still learn more about what's happening, because things change all the time, right? And so that's definitely really important. Know that there won't be a single answer or paths for all undocumented folks. So whether they're students, colleagues, community members, everyone's experience is different, and something that applies to one student, for example, definitely won't apply to other students, right? So definitely know that. And so with that, it's continued investigation, continued learning, continued engagement, right? And so just know that this is gonna be, and has been for a really long time, a continued struggle that we've been having. And it's about sharing information, right? Because that's how we learn. It's by sharing information. And definitely engage with love. I know sometimes that one seems a little like odd, because our perceptions of what love is, but definitely, if you care about the community, if you care about justice, you really engage with love and respecting of differences. Number 6 is to create a supportive space. And so this one is really important, because I've been asked this question quite a few times. Definitely, to create a supportive space, do not ask folks about their immigration status, and also don't assume about folks' immigration status. I think sometimes, definitely, assumptions are natural, but definitely don't ask folks about that. You can display visual supporting signs. I put together a sign that just says, welcoming undocumented students, but definitely welcoming the whole community. And so there's some available at the table as well. The other thing is to make resources available to everyone, because what I have read in a lot of research is that a lot of folks come from mixed status households, meaning that some folks are undocumented and some folks aren't. And so making the information available to everybody just kind of perpetuates that learning and advocating for folks. And so if someone that doesn't directly apply to someone, they can definitely share it with everyone else, right? And be mindful of language. This has also been another thing that has come up during my time here, is using terms like illegal immigrants, aliens, or criminals are not useful, and they're very demeaning. And so definitely be mindful of that. Some of the government reports have moved over to use like unauthorized immigrants. Undocumented usually is kind of the overarching term that a lot of folks use. And definitely refer students. If you're unable to help them, I'm here, and a bunch of other folks are here. So definitely refer folks if you're unable to answer their questions or provide the support that they're asking for. Number 7, so we're coming to an end, but number 7 share what you've learned. You know, I think that it's important for individuals to know information, but you know, if someone is unaware of something, share what you have learned. You know, that's, again, what I said earlier, that that's how we learn. And whether it's someone telling us what their experience has been through writing in a book, or through a documentary, or through conversations, that's basically, you know, how we learn is by sharing information with each other. And so here I put together, I chose a quote from Elvis that I really, really like. You know, we've kind of really become this type of society that's very anti-critical, and we really disengage with one another. And so I think it's really important to perpetuate critical thinking and always be asking questions so we're able to learn and be more informed, so we're able to act in solidarity and make informed decisions and informed actions, right? So definitely share what you have learned here and beyond. And then my last thing is just to continue to engage, to build community and solidarity. Again, it's just like that continued of sharing information. And really, I think that this issue of immigration is really about treating people with respect. You know, I think it's a lot about dehumanizing folks. And that's not acting out of love. It's not acting out of respect, you know. And so I think it's really important to be able to be in solidarity with folks and to respect one another. To be able to see that we can learn from each other, no matter if you have a master's degree or if you have no degree at all. Right? So these are kind of some of the eight steps that I wanted to share with you all. I didn't want to go too much into detail into each of them just because the resources are very vast, but you know, providing you all with a few links where you can access the information, I think for me was useful to kind of frame it that way. Also, since this is a conversation type of thing, I wanted to kind of allow time for that. And so if anyone has any questions, comments, conversation, that you all want to start, if there was something that was unclear, or something that I said wrong, or misleading, definitely you can let me know. But was this helpful?
This is very helpful, thank you. And I would just like to make sure that people didn't get the idea that, well, I forget whether it was back on six or where it was, but you know, you said something about, you, now that you've learned all this, I know you were saying it sort of tongue-in-cheek, you know, then it was about engaging. And I just wanted to make sure that people don't feel as if they have to know all of the information in order to engage. You know, as you said later, there are resources such as you on campus, so keep, as long as we are welcoming and open to people and treat them with respect and use respectful terms and not be too nosy and all that kind of stuff, we can refer them to other people who can help them more. But I think we can all play a part.
Yeah, I mean, definitely we're not born knowing everything. Right? And we also can never really learn everything. And so I think the engagement part is what I really was trying to pass along to everyone, is that, yeah, I've done months of research and like really memorized a lot of these things, but I still really enjoy engaging with folks and seeing, okay, well, what do you think, you know, or what did you think that this issue was about? And then sharing that information. That's been good for me. Yes?
Could you tell me your education for immigration or your volunteer?
No, I work here. So, well, technically, I'm an AmeriCorps member. So, in the wording, we are technically volunteers, but we are paid. And so, here, I'm here only for a year to do this work. And then someone else will come and continue to do some.
I suppose specifically speaking of your training?
My training to share information about what I just shared about?
Or receive information.
So I have, you know, attended a lot of educational forums. I have done a lot of research on my own. I have been to trainings that are related to this issue.
Okay, the reason I'm asking is So therefore, immigrants, specifically where, and I'm so sorry I was not here for the whole event, I'm here this day. Though I'm assuming within assemblies at specific places accommodate the immigrants arriving here from other countries with issues, well, mental as well as physical problems arising from another person, another subject, not person. So therefore you have counseling sessions for immigrants as well?
No, I do not.
So therefore security is specifically your statement.
I'm not really understanding what your question is, if that was a question. But basically what it is that, you know, I'm the Dreamer Support Navigator here at Seattle Central College. I advocate for undocumented students, colleagues, and community members here. All of this information that I presented on today is public information. I have spent months researching about, you know, some things that have been going on at the federal, at the state level, and the local level. And so, and I've also attended a lot of presentations and a lot of trainings. And so it's just continued sharing information about what I have learned, about what this issue is about, and why should all folks really be engaged in this, because it's a really important issue that really affects all of us. And so that's the information that I'm just continuing to share.
Okay, it's just curious, do you care within the immigrant's path regarding our communities? And so therefore, I'm just curious of the counseling as well as the cognitive behavior within struggles. That's all. Thank you.
I have a question. So you said that today was the deadline for DACA to apply, right? So what happens if they don't meet that deadline?
So a variety of things. Some folks are not able to renew,
okay.
And so their DACA work permit is active until it expires. So folks who have DACA or DACA recipients, they have two things. They have the DACA work authorization, and they have the Social Security that they're able to keep for the rest of their life. And so the work authorization is really what is expiring. For folks, if folks are not able to renew, then they'll just have it until the expiration date on their card. The folks who are able to renew, then it's for an additional 2 years, which will go about to 2019. Some folks, there was really a lot of work being done around raising the fee to pay the renewal process, which was $495. And so a lot of organizations have come together and donated money. A lot of folks did fundraising and different types of things that were going on. And so a lot of organizations provided scholarships to DACA recipients to be able to submit their renewal application. The other thing is that a lot of folks that I know, say for example, personally, have submitted their application already because only 3 USCIS offices were accepting DACA applications, and for the state of Washington, folks have to send it to Chicago, the Chicago office. And so if folks weren't able to get it on time, then we'll see what happens. But, you know, a lot of that work had started since the announcement was made on September 3rd. Is that clear?
My name is Olaf, and I'm a student as well as I'm also working with ASC that is associated with student as well. Some folks have suggested within the executive of the student body have suggested to shoot a video that we show support of the undocumented the dreamers. How do you think that will help? Or do you have any other ways that we can engage in helping? Yes, that's my question.
Well, definitely all the 8 things I just shared, you know, I think are really important. Sharing visible support, I think is really great. And so the more you see folks like having signs or like talking about about it, or, you know, wearing pins, or definitely going out to rallies or different things like that is really important. So showing the visible support, I think, is really useful. And so with a video, I think that would be a great idea. But definitely continue, you know, if there was something that you learned today that you didn't know before, continue sharing that. You know, I think that that's really important. And so just continue engaging with folks to understand the immigration system, understand the documented populations. They seem so simple, right, to learn, but they're so useful, you know, they are so useful.
So let's say there's a family, and the kids are born in the U.S., and then the parents are not, don't have the documents, and they can't report it. So since the kids are born in the U.S., can they take with them, or is it just by, there's a law that basically protects the, because I heard that the kids have to stay here, and then they deport the parents.
Right. So again, these are the types of questions, you know, that of course I'm not a lawyer, you know, but I can share some things that I do know that have happened. One of the things is that usually kids are left with another adult family member if the parents are deported. Sometimes in situations like that, of family members whose parents are deported, over the years or once they turn 18, then they're able to petition for their parents, but as minors, they're not able to do that. Sometimes the kids go back, I mean, it really depends on the family, right? Sometimes the kids do go back, but, you know, they can legally, I guess, be here, and often they're left with another adult that's here in the U.S. So it really depends, but I mean, this is what part of the immigration system, you know, that it's like really, really complex. Who's able to petition for folks, who is able to then become a U.S. citizen through the naturalization process. I mean, it really takes a lot of years, but that's why definitely learning about the immigration system, to learn about these technicalities and what happens in certain, you know, situations is important to kind of learn.
And so it's 2 years is the max they can sign on the federal government?
For the work authorization is 2 years at a time. So when folks first applied for DACA, the work permit was for 2 years at a time, but they could apply for the social security number right when they got DACA, and that stays with them regardless if the work authorization is still active or not. So in the future, say for example right now, one of the things that's in Congress is the DREAM Act 2017. And so say Congress passes that as a law, what it would allow is for anyone who currently has DACA to automatically get conditional permanent residency. And then from there, they would wait about 8 years to then be eligible for lawful permanent residency, which is a green card. And then from there, usually the estimated time is 5 years to be able to naturalize, which is a U.S. citizen, to become a U.S. citizen. So that's like a total of 13 years, you know. But the work authorization is still available, and a few other things that folks would probably still be able to do. So you all can definitely follow that, your comments.
Sierra,
yeah,
maybe you could just do a very short explanation of, and I know that it's very complex. So when we talk about unauthorized immigrants or undocumented people, there's that broader. And then when we talk about, say, maybe dreamers, and then when we talk about DACA identified individuals. So maybe just a short overview of that. Because DACA folks are very specific.
Yes. Excuse me. Yeah. So this is one of the from this number to here. So if you all take a look at some of these resources, you all will learn a few things. So one is understanding what undocumented status is, right? So someone who is undocumented or has that status, it means someone doesn't have U.S. citizenship, that they don't have lawful permanent residency. It's also commonly known as a green card. They're not a current visa holder, whether it's a student visa, a work visa, a tourist visa. They're not current or don't have current status as refugees or asylum seekers, although a lot of folks are, you know, fleeing from their country. And so it's otherwise anyone who does not have legal authorization from the U.S. government to be in the United States. And so anyone who falls out of those categories, then they're considered undocumented. So for example, if someone comes here on a student visa, and then they're only here for the period of time that they've been allowed to be here, and they go over that time and stay in the United States past that date, then they would be considered like out of status, and they would be considered undocumented because they no longer have authorization to be in the United States, right? And so there's different ways that folks come into the country. So one of them is a visa overstay. The other one is many folks cross the many borders that we have, not just the southern border, but the border with Canada or through the oceans that we have bordering this country. Or some folks do enter the country with false documents, whether it's using someone else's documents or falsifying some documents. And so those are kind of the top three ways that folks usually, or that the government has recorded that folks come into the U.S. And so one of the things that I definitely am doing within my work is using the undocumented students, specifically because I work with students, the umbrella of undocumented students, because anyone who has DACA, they're still undocumented. Because DACA is primarily the work permit and you know, a few other things that folks are able to do with the deferred action, but it's not a path to citizenship, it's not a path to a green card, and it's not a visa. And so those folks are still undocumented, and then even with Dreamers, that kind of identity has really stuck around because of the Dream Act, but Dreamer doesn't have any legal status. It's just kind of a term that's used to reference the population of folks who would be eligible for the Dream Act. And so a lot of those folks are DACA recipients. And so a lot of the population of DACA is childhood arrivals, so it means that a lot of folks were brought here by their parents at a really young age. They went to U.S. public or private schools, they learned English, now, you know, they're going to college, community college, trade schools, universities, etc. And so that's kind of the population that the DACA program was directed towards, and that the DREAM Act also is more or less directed towards. And so undocumented folks, right, they really range, one, the country they come from, at the age that they come to the U.S., the languages they speak, it really varies quite a bit. Yeah.
I have a question regarding the DACA job seekers, for instance. How are they doing how they doing in terms of like finding jobs or applying jobs or etc.? Are they finding any kind of backlash or standard discrimination? Because there are some that, you know, would refer them as illegals or.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Right. So how are they doing that?
This is the other thing, right? Common misconceptions, again, that I will kind of say is that undocumented folks, even though folks don't have social security numbers or anyone who doesn't have DACA doesn't have a work permit, folks can still work in some ways. So the IRS has certain policies that enable folks to be able to work. So a lot of undocumented folks can be independent contractors as long as they apply for an ITIN number, which is a number so you can file your taxes. It's not a social security number. So folks can be independent contractors, they can be business owners, and do a lot of other things in relation to that. So there is, you know, a few things. I mean, I think the paying taxes and being able to work is kind of a thing that a lot of people get mixed up a little bit. And so there are a few things that folks are still do you all have, I mean, what's the feedback you all have? Or, you know, did you all learn something? Or was something really interesting that you were like, whoa, that's really cool? Or something you don't agree with?
No, actually, it's interesting because I, this morning, on my way to school, I heard a news from India. They were talking about how it was a lot of people. Some people are panicking, some people are in different stages of emotion.
Yeah, so, you know, I definitely urge you all to pass along the information I provided to you all. We'll share the PowerPoints and you all can go to all the links from the resources that I have here for you all. I have some handouts and materials if you all would like to, take some materials with you all. The other thing that I'm doing here on campus is aside from engaging folks about the work that I do, I also have scholarship workshops. A lot of scholarships require for students to be U.S. citizens or have a green card or a visa. But I really look for scholarships that don't require proof of citizenship or any type of proof of immigration status. And so that's something that I'm doing throughout throughout the quarter and throughout the year. So I have a scholarship list of about maybe 20 scholarships that don't require proof of citizenship that folks are able to apply to. So I have them this year, and I'll be having the workshop next week on Tuesday, October 10th. So if you all are interested in that, you're more than welcome to come and definitely share with folks as well.
All right, let's thank you. Some folks have additional questions that they prefer to ask one-on-one, but as the hearing has a little bit of time, maybe you should be open to folks approaching and having conversations. You just got a brief survey that I'd love if you fill out and hand to either me or Elisa, moving right over there in the corner. And yeah, have a fantastic day. If you are passionate about an issue, we have students, staff, faculty members, community members come and lead these sessions around a variety of social issues. So we have the fall schedule that's currently put together, but if you're interested in being on the winter schedule or spring or have a recommendation, feel free to let me know and I can pursue that. So thank you for your time and attention. Continue learning.